coffee in the lobby. We watch our worship on the screen. We got a rock star preacher who won't wake us from our dreams. We want our blessings in our pocket. We keep our missions overseas. For the hurting in our city, or would we even cross the street? But we want to see the heart set free and the tyrants kneel. The walls fall down and our land be healed. But church, if we want to see change in the world out there, it's got to start right here. It's got to start right now.
Welcome. Happy New Year. I'm thankful that you're able to join us either live or on Facebook. We have quite a few people on today on Facebook. We have quite a few people that are sick in the church, and special prayers out to the Lewis family, since I think nearly every one of them have COVID. So I don't think there's anything too serious so far about it, but we've just been praying for them and keep them in your prayers. Thankful that we have a God that we can turn to in times like this. One thing I wanted to mention, it's been a weird year, but as we were passing out the tithe boxes today for some of you that use the tithe envelopes, I was just thinking back through the year and how faithful you guys have been. How faithful you have been to the church, how faithful you have been to share your resources with the church, how faithful you have been to Jeanette and I in providing for us and making sure that we are not struggling and encouraging us. There's been many people behind the scenes that have text us and send us cards and have really just sort of kept us uplifted through this time. And I just thank you, all of you, for what you have done, what you continue to do. I mean, it would be very easy in times like these for the church to fall apart. And yet, you guys have continued to be faithful. No matter whether you're doing it on Facebook or coming live, no matter how that you have been able to support us, I just wanted to praise you right now and thank God for you. And I hope that you know that God is still here to bless us. And he wants those blessings to be shared together, and let us do that today. If you have a need, let us know. I mean, it's so easy because I'm at the front of the church that it's easy to encourage me, but make sure that we're encouraging each other. I know a lot of you are calling people that are not able to come. I thank you for that. But let's continue to make sure that we're encouraging each other through these times. And it's not just the pastor, it is all of us that are providing that encouragement. Well, do you believe that God is a great God?
Amen.
I do too. Why don't we stand and worship together? Come to the time of the service where we celebrate and we worship God for the ability to communicate to Him. I've been using this term lately of having relational conversations with God. And I don't know that we always look at prayer in that way, but see, when Jesus came, it changed. In the past, it was prayer as in I'm like trying to lift them up to God. But when Jesus came, And what we celebrate at Christmas is that it was almost like God reaching His hand down to us and said, "Here, let's talk. You tell me what's going on. Let's have this conversation that's real. You know, like one of the things I think we struggle with our parents sometimes, and perhaps this was only me when I was younger, it was hard at times to speak about the truth or the real things, the real struggles that you're having. But our Heavenly Father, He can handle it. One of the great things that we can praise Him for is the fact that He cares enough that we can give Him whatever we are struggling with. And I'm not going to, you know, continually bring up 2020 as this bad, horrible time, because for some of us, it was a time of thanksgiving. As horrible as it was still a time of thanksgiving. And I refuse to put it in such a light that says that it was a complete wasted year. You'll hear that often now in the media today. It was like we should throw it away. I learned so much about God in 2020. I learned about His faithfulness. I learned about how He would be there and He would hear my prayers no matter what. And what we worship and we pray about right now and what we take this moment to celebrate is the fact that no matter what is going on, He hears our needs. He cares enough. And I think way too often, we don't talk to our Father enough. And I hope in these moments that we remind ourselves, you don't have to have a PhD in prayer to talk to Him. You don't have to be eloquent. You know, there's some people when they're praying, you're almost weeping because they have this ability to pray in such a way that it's unbelievable. And you're like, boy, if I could just pray just a little bit more like that, maybe my prayer. No. Effective prayer comes from your willingness to speak to your Father. If you're online and you put in the comment field prayers, I know the Lewis family's in our prayers. I know Athea Dutton, Keith is home today because she is not feeling well. I know there are many that are struggling, like myself, with sinuses and stuff like that. And, you know, I know family members who are struggling with, I'll just mention his name's Bob Hamm, who was a friend of my mom and dad's, and I knew him when I was younger. He was a little bit younger than I was. I mean, 2 days ago, the doctor walks in weeping and saying there's nothing they can do about his lung issues from COVID. 40 years old, family. They call out this worldwide prayer. It goes really far. The doctor comes in the next day and says, I don't know what happened, but he's better. He's got a long ways to go. Who knows where the Lord is going to take that? But what I am thankful for is that when somebody is struggling like that, that we can gather together as a global church and pray for them. I believe they had people praying in India. I believe they had people praying in the United States. I believe they had people praying all over. The power of prayer is real. When we deny or when we don't use it, I believe that we miss out on some of the true blessings of God. It's why we take the moment every week to stop and talk about it. Because I want to encourage you to pray, and I want to encourage you to at sometimes even fast and pray. There are so many people right now that are struggling. Let us keep our prayers for them on our lips, in our minds. For those that are isolated, for those that are alone, may they find that comfort in the Lord. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to You right now. We thank You for the opportunity to speak to You, to intercede on for others, and to just bear our own souls to You, Lord. Lord, we are so thankful that You have promised that You will hear our prayers, that You will take those prayers and in your righteous way, make anew in the situation. Come near those right now that are suffering, Lord. May they feel your presence. May they know that you are a real God. May your glory abound in everything. May we praise you extensively for everything that you do. And Lord, right now I anticipate all the great things that you are about to do. Let us all say together, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Lord. And they all said, amen. Let's stand and worship again.
Please remain standing for the scripture reading.
Good morning. Today I'm reading Matthew 6, 19 through 21. Do not lay up for yourselves treasures on earth, where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But lay up for yourselves treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust destroys and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there will be heart. Where your there your heart will be also.
We all said,
amen.
You can be seated.
Wherever you find yourself, whatever is happening, however you feel, take courage. God is with you. When you seek him, he will be found by you. When you call to him, he will answer. And when you knock, he will open the door. Do not fear or give up. Be strong. Still your quaking knees. Strengthen your hands. Your heavenly Father will help you. He will go ahead of you, and he will strengthen you. As you go about your day, meditate on his word. And when you wake at night, trust in his promises. Every one of them is yes and amen. Hide his word in your heart. Don't add to it or take away from it. Follow his commands. Don't turn from them to the left or to the right. When you place yourself in his hands, you will prosper in every battle you face. Wherever you go, he is with you. He will never fail you or forsake you. Seek him with all your heart and soul. Step into his purposes. Align your heart with his heart, your actions with his actions. His covenant can never be broken. It stands firm through the ages. Take courage. Make him your fortress, your shield, your stronghold, and your deliverer. Whatever enemy or foe you face, do not be terrified because of them. You're fighting in God's army. You're called to possess this land. He promises to give you every place you set your foot. Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid. Put your hope in him, your Savior and your God. Remember his righteous acts, the days of victory. Rise up, break out in song. He is the one who enables you to stand, who arms you with strength for the battle, who preserves you and delivers you. And he is the one who will bring you through.
Well, congratulations. You have made it to 2021. If you're a sci-fi person, many of the movies that you watched in the past were before 2021, so you're in the future, in the sci-fi time. So I know like the Terminator was before 2021, the original one. So we've made it past some of the predictions of the sci-fi channel and stuff like that. So way to go, way to go. How awesome. You know, when we think of a new year, I think often we use it as a time to sort of think of new beginnings, you know, like new diets, new exercise programs. I'm not going to do this. I'm going to be new at this. I'm going to be new at that. I'm going to have a new attitude. You know, a lot of people now, even those that drink heavy alcohol, use January as a no alcohol month. And so the world sees the beginning of the year as a new beginning, a new hope. Even perhaps this crossing over the river to new promises. And when I think about that, when I thought about, you know, what would I preach on today, for some reason I thought of Joshua. And, you know, you heard a little bit of it in that video. In fact, Scott and I did not talk about this. This is actually part of the scripture I will be using today. That's how God sort of works in things. But see, Joshua was chosen. And I think we have to understand who Joshua was. See, Joshua was this great general of Moses. And at some point, Moses has figured out that in Deuteronomy that he's not going to the promised land. He had brought the Israelites through 40 years wandering in the wilderness. He's not going to do it. And God has chosen Joshua to lead the Israelites into the promised land. I think for him, there is this sense of, well, I'm not good enough. I mean, you got to remember, his idol was Moses. For then on, the Israelites saw Moses almost as a god. There is some suggestion why Moses had to, like when he passed away, that he passed not in front of them, was so that they would not deify him, not make him into a god. And so that's who Joshua is following. And it's very difficult sometimes when a person has to follow somebody like a Moses. It's not that easy. And I'm sure there was some of this lack of confidence. And then you add on top of that, that the promised land had all this potential. It was so wonderful. It was a land of milk and honey. It was everything they ever wanted. And yet, it was scary and formidable. There were giants in their eyes. There were things that they would never, ever be able to conquer on their own. And Joshua is given the task not only to take himself across the river, which he's already been. Remember, he's one of the spies that goes across. And he's only one of two, him and Caleb, that comes back and says, let's go get it. We can do it. God's on our side. And everybody else goes, oh no. So they wander another 40 years. But now Joshua has to be a leader and take the Israelites across the river to the promised land. And I'm sure he had probably been praying. I'm sure God recognized that his new chosen leader didn't have complete confidence. I will tell you, as a leader, not every day are you confident. I love reading autobiographies, like Ronald Reagan's an autobiography that I found interesting. I read his letters. And one of the things you'll find about every third day, he's like, I'm the worst president ever to live. Yet today we tried to lift him up to be the greatest president. He didn't think that. Leaders, every day, whether they show it outwardly, struggle with self-doubt. Am I doing the right thing in this moment? And I will tell you, for myself at least, this year of COVID has exasperated that. But then I read Joshua, who had the burden of a nation. And in Joshua chapter 1, verse 6, it reads, and it is the title of my sermon today, Be Strong and of Good Courage. If you leave out of here with nothing else, I hope that you are equipped with those words. Be strong and with good courage. For to this people you shall divide as an inheritance the land which I swore to their fathers to give them. Verse 7, only be strong and very courageous, that you may observe to do according to all the law which Moses, my servant, commanded you. Do not turn from it to the right hand or to the left, that you may prosper wherever you go. Verse 8, this book of the law shall not depart from your mouth, but you shall meditate in it day and night, that you may observe to do according to all that is written in it. For then you will make your way prosperous, and then you will have good success. Verse 9, have I not commanded you? Be strong and courageous. Do not be afraid, nor be dismayed, for the Lord your God is with you wherever you go. You know, I think if we would have met Joshua, he would have seemed like a fierce man to us. Bravery would not have been a question of Joshua's. I mean, the guy literally went into the promised land before and was a spy. It wasn't like he was fighting his courage. It wasn't that he was fighting his bravery. It was none of that. But yet God saw fit over three different scriptures in a very short period of time to tell him to be brave, to be bold, and to be courageous, to be strong and of good courage. And from that, God gives him the promises that I believe that not only he could stand on, but we can stand on. It first says, be strong and of good courage, and receive the promises of God. What's God promised you? He has promised that he would never leave you nor forsake you. He's promised that he would be there for you. He's promised that if you pray to him, that he will hear your prayers. He's promised that he loves you. He's promised peace. When we are strong and courageous, we can live in those promises. They were never going to get in the promised land if they were not going to be courageous enough to follow God's will. As Christians today, we must ask ourselves, am I being strong and courageous enough to follow God's will no matter what is going on? You are going to get beat down as a Christian unless you are willing to be strong and courageous. Secondly, it says, be strong and of good courage, and prosper in the righteousness of God. Now, this is not a prosperity statement. You're not going to become a millionaire just because you're a Christian. But you can prosper in the righteousness of God. There's a difference. You want your marriage to be stronger? You will prosper in the righteousness of God. You want your friendships to be stronger? You will prosper in the righteousness of God. Let's make sure we understand what righteousness is. It's to be right with God. It is to do what God says is right. You know, we wonder sometimes, well, why is my marriage failing? Well, are you doing what God says is righteous? Why are my friendships failing? Are you doing what God says is righteous? Why is my community failing? Why is my church failing? Why is my country failing? Are you doing what God says is righteous? And when we do, we will prosper. Other countries have seen that. Other countries said, we need to get Christianity because look how prosperous the United States was because that's what they follow. But sometimes we miss that today. We miss the fact that in God we trust, that there was a prosper in that. Again, it's not prosperity that we are seeking. It is that in the righteousness of God, our lives will prosper. Thirdly, be strong and of good courage. Cast aside fear and doubt, because your God is with you wherever you go. I'm sure that if I asked you guys to raise your hand right now, I'm not going to. Do you have any fear and doubt? I mean, even some of you are willing to shake your head yes. It is so easy to allow fear and doubt to invade your life if you're not strong and courageous. It is so easy for the liar to speak in your ear these whispers of fear and doubt if we are not strong and courageous. And notice it doesn't say that we're just strong and courageous. It says we're strong and courageous because God is with you wherever you are. you go. It's a lot easier to be strong and courageous if you got a bodyguard. You know, you hear some of these people, you know, talking about, well, you don't need protection, you can just walk around and it doesn't matter, blah, blah, blah. And they got this entourage of bodyguards behind them protecting them. What is the blessings of God is that how we can be courageous is that God is our bodyguard. That God is our protection. He is our fortress. He is our high tower. He is the hedge that protects us. And we can be stronger and we can be more courageous when we recognize that He is our protector. You know, I think about that statement. God is my protector. And I think always about how, you know, if God is for us, who can be against us? There's a new commercial out, and I think it's for an insurance company. I've been watching a lot of TV lately, especially football and stuff like that. And one of the commercials is, it is so easy, and then they cut to a picture, and they're picking pickup basketball teams with these little kids. And then there's this Charles Barkley who's like 6'8 or 6'9, and he's picked first. And it's and the commercial is something like, it's so easy that you would know to pick Charles Barkley as your starter for your team, the first person on your team. And I think when you start to realize that God is your protector, it's so much easier to be courageous. It's so much easier that when you're feeling like you're being attacked, like you're being hated, or that anything that is causing these issues in your life, it's so much easier when you recognize, without a doubt, that God is there to protect you. I mean, that's what Joshua does. I mean, understand, Joshua rolls into the Promised Land with the Israelites, and they go to Jericho, and they march around Jericho 7 times, and the place falls. They would have never done that if it wasn't for the fact that they knew God was with them. And God had to remind them, as I am trying to remind you today, that we must be strong and courageous. That God expects us to be strong and courageous. But He does not expect us to produce the strength or produce the courage. That is the most wonderful part about this. You know, the Israelites were not the biggest. They were not the strongest. They're not the best equipped. They were not the richest. They had a protector who was God. And because of that, they could march into the Promised Land and know that He was with them. Why didn't they do that 40 years ago? Because they did not believe that God was their protector, that God was with them. Today, as Christians, we need to start acting like that God is with us. Thus, we can be strong and courageous. You know, I think in this time, I think it's important for us to understand that. But perhaps a writer in the New Testament that had a worse period of time than we have this year was Paul. I mean, they hated him. They beat him. I mean, they beat him almost to death. They stoned him and thought he was dead. They actually drug him out of the city, laid him on the ground, and he was stoned and he was dead. And somehow he stands back up and keeps on walking. Where does he go? Back into the city. So Paul, if no one else, should have been demoralized, should have been discouraged, should have been down on everything, but instead he walked with his head high and he wrote these wonderful verses that talked about no matter what's going on, it's okay because God is with us. And when we begin to recognize, as Paul did, that our strength and our courage, in fact, Paul at one point says, you know, in my weakness, God makes me strong. Do you feel weak today? I'll be honest with you. Yesterday, Jeanette doubted I was going to be standing up here today. I was a mess. But in our weakness, we don't produce the strength that we need. God does. And Paul writes in Romans chapter 5, verse 1, therefore, having been justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom also we have access by faith into his grace in which we stand and rejoice in hope of the glory of God. You see, when we accept Jesus Christ as our Lord and Savior, when we believe that we are his chosen, that we are his, that it begins to create in us this ability to stand up in all adversity, to stand up no matter what's going on. Later in Philippians, he writes, I know what it's like to have a little. I know what it's like to have a lot. I know what it means to be poor and hungry, and I know what it means to be full and blessed. And then he says, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. You want strength? You want courage? Put all of it on Jesus Christ. When we say, put Jesus in the center and everything's better, what the reality of that is that if you want to be stronger, put Jesus in the center of your life. If you want to be more courageous, put Jesus in the center of your life. Paul recognizes that our salvation is partially what drives the fact that we can rely upon God because he is ours and we are his. We become family. We become kin. We become his protected. And no matter what's going on, he can equip us to go through the deepest valleys and the highest mountains. He can make it so that we can move forward in the worst of times. And when we do have those great times, we even then need his help. How many people do you know that have prosperity and then fall flat on their face because they don't rely on the Lord anymore? We don't recognize where my help comes from is the Lord. We don't recognize that our resources come from the Lord. We don't realize that our love comes from the Lord. We don't realize that everything that we have is the Lord's. And if we would be more like that as Christians, we could be stronger and courageous in the worst of the moments and in the best of the moments. It takes as much strength and as much courage to have everything, to have no issues and still serve the Lord, as it does to have wonderful or horrible things going on in our lives and still serve the Lord. It takes as much courage no matter what we are doing. God requires us to have strength and courage. You know, I can't sing, but I love the old hymns and some of their messages, and I think I've used this one often. It always is on the tip of my tongue. But I love when the old hymn says, because he lives, I can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because he lives, life is worth the living. Just because he lives. See, Paul recognizes that there is a gift of God, that when we receive salvation, it is a gift, a fortified faith that we receive that allows us to be strong, to be courageous. All this allows Paul to write 3 to 5. I ask you, can you write verses 3 to 5 in your own life? It's not the easiest verses to read, but there's truth in them. Verse 3, and not only that, but he also glory, but we also glory in tribulations, knowing that tribulations produce perseverance. James 1, 2 to 4, we have joy in our trials and tribulations. Are you joyful? Not easy. But why does Paul say that we glory in our tribulations? We find worth in them, knowing that tribulations produce perseverance. And what does perseverance mean? The Greek word, which I won't pronounce, Mary and Fayer online, they would just laugh at me if I tried to pronounce any Greek words. I love them to death. I wish I could like have them pronounce the word and we cut it in when I say it so it'd be precise and accurate. But perseverance, the Greek word for that, means to have endurance, especially to patiently endure. I like the way that talks. When you hear those words, patiently endure. I'll be honest with you, there have been times in the near past where I felt like that this patient endurance was a requirement. Perhaps you have felt that way. Perhaps there was times you're like, I wish this would just get over with. I wish it would go on. I wish we could get back to normal. But instead, we're trying to have this patient endurance, which is perseverance. And what Paul says is that in trials and tribulations, that this gift, this fruit, now understand in Galatians it says long-suffering. So patience is a gift from the Holy Spirit. So I would suggest to you that if we are going to be able to patiently endure, it is because we recognize that our patience comes from God. He's patient. Here's how I know he's patient. One of the greatest graces God ever gives is that he waits for you to come to him. He tarries. There has been many a times that he could have took my life, but he waited so that the prodigal would come home. He was patient. And he shares that patience with us in the fruit of the Spirit. And because of that, we should celebrate when we recognize that this tribulation is teaching us to be patiently waiting for God's work to happen. Have you been sick and you kept praying that God would heal you? Have you had a circumstance in your life that you want to be changed? Have you asked God? And it seems like, not today. The question is, can you be patient? Can you learn to be patient and endure? And if you are, the promise then is, according to Paul, is that patience, or patiently enduring, perseverance, and perseverance, this is verse 4, and perseverance creates character. Now, not like character like he's a character. Not like that kind of character. When I see words like that that could have many meanings in the English language, I love going back to the Greek because often when you go back there, you get some clarification of what maybe Paul was talking about. When you go back to character in the Greek, it means to be tried and tested. I didn't ever take character that way. I mean, I think of character, I think of, well, they have good character, but I never thought of what that truly means. And what character, the Greek word for character means, is to be tried and tested, to be proven as true. If you want to be strong and courageous, one of the things that has to happen in your life is that as you have perseverance, it creates in this tried and true understanding that God is in control. He is a sovereign God, a God that can do great things. And He's in control no matter whether you think He's in control or not. And when we understand that when I have patience with God, when I endure with God, and that begins to become something that is tried and true. See, if you've never had a problem, ever, and you finally have one, what are you going to stand upon? You know, in sports, they always say, well, that was a good loss for them, because it's going to teach them something that they'll be able to use in the future. Sometimes that's why we have trials and tribulations, is because that will then give us the ability to understand that God is tried and true, that His promises are tried and true. That creates strength. That creates courage. You cannot stand before the great adversities of our life, staring at death, without knowing that God is tried and true in His promises. It is like we are saying, He has done it before. Surely He will do it again. Do you live your life that way? Do you live your life saying to yourself, well, God's done it in the past, He'll come through again? Strength and courage come from that understanding that the promises of God are tried and true. Four continued, and character, hope. See, hope is trust when there's no reason to. Hope is trust because your faith in Jesus has been tried and tested. Hope is trust because He has been proven to always be enough. Is Christ enough? Is it enough to give you the hope? Can you trust Him? When Joshua is standing, looking across the Jordan River into the Promised Land, and he knew that God had asked him three times to be strong and courageous, at some point, trust had to move his feet forward. Hope had to lighten his heart up enough that he could go. Strength and courage is not developed through our brute force or our fortitude. Strength and courage comes from the hope of Jesus Christ. Comes from the trust in the promises of God. Verse 5, now hope does not disappoint. How can it? It is of God. Because the love of God has been poured out in our hearts by the Holy Spirit who has given to us. And I've said this often, I repeat it here, because I don't believe that we stand in this enough, that we do not place ourselves with this understanding, that one of the greatest blessings God ever gave to us is that when Jesus went to sit next to the Father, he did not leave us alone. You want to be strong and courageous? Know that the Holy Spirit is walking with you. It is a promise of God that the Helper will help you. We'll push through those times. You know, often it feels like, you know, one of the motifs of the Bible is that you're standing upright, another standing righteously against all odds, against all evil. It is almost at times like the Holy Spirit has got his hand on your back, holding you there so you do not fall down, that you do not run away. It is because we have the Holy Spirit that we can be strong and we can be courageous. When we understand that we are never alone, you think about the most scared you've ever been in your life. Typically, it's when you're by yourself. If anybody remembers my sermons from a while back, the squirrel followed me through the dark woods. I was by myself. I would suggest to you, often the scariest moments we have is when we feel like we're alone. But when we realize that the Holy Spirit is with us because of the Lord Jesus Christ has given us the salvation and has provided us a helper, we are never alone. Strength and courage comes from the understanding that we are never alone. I close with this quote that I found on the internet this week. It was not attributed to anybody in particular, but I found the quote interesting. I found the quote encouraging. And I think it embodies this sentiment of this sermon. Our hope is not in the new year, but in the one who makes all things new. Unfortunately, there is no magical moment that when the clock strikes midnight, December 31st, and we flip the calendar over, there's no magic that makes it completely different after that. January 1st and December 31st, if you had a circumstance on December 31st, you likely have it on January 1st. But if you put your hope in the one that can make things new, everything can change. Everything can change. There is nothing that our Lord and Savior cannot do. And when we are armed with that, we can be strong and courageous. No matter the adversity, no matter the tribulation, no matter whether it's good times or bad, we can be strong and courageous. What God is asking of us as a church is to act like we're strong and courageous, to begin to share that with others, not only from words, but from our actions. Often our words are strong, perhaps even hurtful at times. But are our hands and our feet strong and courageous? Are we willing to be there for others? Especially today, it's hard because of the COVID. But the reality of it is, God has given us the ability to still help others in this time. And I hope that you pray about that. I hope that you fast about that. And you ask yourself, how do I become more strong, more courageous? And how do I help the church to be stronger and courageous so that we can be a shining light in this time of need? The hope is not in a new year. The hope is in our Lord Jesus Christ. Let us pray. Our Heavenly Father, Lord, we come to you right now. We're so thankful that you are there for us. We're so thankful that you have given us the ability to be strong and courageous. But Lord, perhaps many of us don't feel that strong, don't feel that courageous. Perhaps many of us right now are not even sure how to take another step forward. Lord, I ask that you give the gift of fortified faith. Strengthen each person right now that is praying with me and is asking for your help, Lord. Give them the understanding that you are trustworthy, that you are reliable, that if we stand on your promises, that we will prosper in your righteousness. Lord, for all those that are ill or struggling right now, touch them. May they feel your presence right now. May they start to feel your strength. May they start to feel the boldness and the courage that only you can provide. Help us as a church be there for them. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.
Sometimes it's moments of brokenness which create the greatest transformations. Times where fear gives birth to faith, pain leads to healing, and chaos dissolves into peace. It's in these times we often see God more clearly. For in our deepest turmoil, He remains faithful. When our spirit is crushed, He remains strong. When our moment is too heavy, He carries the burden. As gold is refined by fire, we too are often refined by struggle. It's part of growing, changing, becoming. Lately, the journey has been difficult. Our breath has been labored. Our steps uneasy. But we stand in faith, knowing who is leading us through this desert. The God of peace, the God of hope, the God of restoration.